historic cricket was introduced into the milieu of assessment in 1975 by Harding and colleagues, and to improve its psychometric properties, standardized patients or simulated or artificial patients are part of the process. Also, the use of clinical skills laboratory facilitates the use of HOSCI as both a training and assessment format. Functionally, it is a timed clinical examination in which students move from station to station, each station requiring performance of specific clinical tasks in a simulated setting that involves interaction with actual or simulated or standardized or real patients. An HOSCI examination contains usually 10 to 20 stations, each lasting 5 to 20 minutes depending on what is being tested and the level of testing. A group of stations form a circuit. Each station is manned by two or three examiners who assess the candidate performance of the required task and award marks based on predetermined criteria called checklists or marking guides. Candidates rotate through the stations, completing all the stations on their circuit. In this way, all candidates take the same station and are assessed on the same path. Best HOSCI stations are created from real clinical scenarios. You can do that as you see your patients daily in the clinic. There are some weaknesses associated with the traditional clinical examination. That's why HOSCI. For instance, what we call case specificity, in which one case may be used to determine the fate of a candidate. Long case, it may be difficult, it may be easy, and be a sort of advantage to the candidate. Fewer examiners to determine the examinee's fate. Examiner personality or bias or idiosyncrasies coming to traditional clinical exams. Inbuilt luck, different levels of difficulty across clinical cases. Patient's factor may be difficult or cooperative patient. Fewer number of examination points, maybe 1 or 2 points used to determine somebody's fate. Examiner intimidation, we know that, how examiners can intimidate examinees. Examiner undue interference in exam process. Unobserved candidate-patient interaction, you don't know how the candidate interacted with the patient to obtain the history. Lack of informed examiner's ethics. Lack of examiner's training and acceptable examination conduct. Non-standardization, and as a result, lower validity and reliability are some of the inherent weaknesses in traditional clinical examination. When you compare with HOSCI, you find that a combination of multiple observations, what we call stations, and the standardization of content and difficulty across the board for all students have made HOSCI a very popular evaluation tool. In an HOSCI, each station has different examiners. Thus, it is possible for a candidate to pass through 20 to 30 different examiners during an HOSCI exam. This provides validity evidence and ensures reliability of the exam process. It has been extensively studied and established as a very good assessment instrument in virtually every medical discipline with excellent psychometric properties, that is validity and reliability. HOSCI has been shown to have much higher reliability and validity than traditional and other less structured clinical examination. HOSCI and traditional examination can test similar things, but for different approaches. However, the traditional format will test a narrower scope of content, whereas HOSCI can test much more wider content, being more flexible. In HOSCI, the examiner only observes the candidate without interruption or asking questions. This way, the candidate has ample opportunity to demonstrate his ability or inability and be adequately assessed. We should know that summative assessment is not the period for teaching candidates, but people do that a lot in traditional exams. Some HOSCI modifications can allow for structured questioning by examiners, we know that. In HOSCI, questions on patient management are captured through what we call follow-up stations or post-encounter, so that there is place to test management or what would have been like discussion in the old traditional method. As a result of all this, HOSCI is now extensively used in medical schools throughout the world. It is used for assessing medical students, interns, residents, and candidates for licensure and certification. It's also extended used by other health professionals. It reduces the duration of time for conducting clinical examinations. It is additionally advantageous when the number of students is high. It enables specific competencies and skills to be measured, which are either not captured or masked by the traditional clinical examination. It is very flexible and can be adapted to test many forms of skills and competencies. This is facilitated, as I said, by the use of clinical skills laboratories. As we say, examiner's imagination is only limit. Stations can be created for rare clinical situations and assessed by the examiners. OSCE provides more room for assessment of many clinical skills. Perform an EKG, interpret an EEG, give medical precision, read an X-ray, insert an IV line, suture skill station, obtain blood pressure measure, endotracheal intubation catheterization, and other high fidelity simulation mannequins can be used to do a lot of other things. Other advantages are in communication and interpersonal skills, which are very well tested and which are grossly inadequate in traditional examination. If you want to test how to obtain informed consent, notification of medical error, notification of death, patient counseling, explaining a clinical procedure, these are very, very easily carried out in OSCE. You can have patient education, giving medical advocacy. These are all advantages. Other benefits: instills confidence in students, especially when you have clinical skills laboratory, and mannequins are used to learn skills and invasive procedures. It prepares students better for clinical practice because it's also a training tool. Students achieve deeper and more meaningful learning because can do repetitive actions on mannequins before coming to the patient. It facilitates the assessment of psychomotor skills as well as knowledge and attitude. You can test the affective domain deeper than you can do in traditional. It provides a great platform for student feedback. There are some potential weaknesses. People say patients are segmentalized, compartmentalized. One case is history, one is examination, one is discussion. Yes, that's possible. Short duration of stations may inhibit ability for in-depth history taking or physical examination or discussion of management. What will we increase the time? Of course, they are resource intensive in terms of staff, equipment, and clinical laboratories. They entail intensive time-consuming preparations, training examiners, students, sample makers, and the logistics involved. Some students find OSCE stressful. There's extensive documentation and paperwork. It needs good knowledge of electronic data management, that spreadsheet. Overscoring over performance of students can happen if checklists are poorly designed. If you want to carry out an OSCE, what are the steps? Form an OSCE committee. It's not HOD, one-man army. You have a committee. You construct an exam blueprint. You train students. You train teachers. You write the cases and the probes. Construct checklists for each case. Recruit and train SPs. All real patients. Pilot the exam and revise it as needed. Conduct the full-scale exam. Analyze the results and report results. Now, what is the blueprint? Blueprint is nothing but a platform, a template in which you capture every aspect of the curriculum. What we call systematic sampling, ensuring that no area of the curriculum is left untested. You can do this through what we call test blueprint or table of specifications to ensure balanced coverage and sampling of the content domain. Experts can do it from their knowledge of the specialty. All right? And one of the things you must do in constructing test of specification, table of specification, is to make sure you determine the things to be tested. First of all, you realize you cannot test everything. And so for you, prioritize knowledge or skills you want to assess. First of all, know the core issues, must know, from should know, and from nice to know. You can't be testing nice to know and you leave core issues. Again, you should determine the length of time available for your examination. Determine the number of stations that will be needed. Weight the stations accordingly and appropriately. They cannot weight the same. Determine if a number of rest stations. What will be the duration of each station? How many stations will be patient or task related? That is the case characteristics.
Do you have any post-encounter proof or complaint station? How will you do your scoring? By checklist, by rating scale, compensatory or non-compensatory scoring? You have to think of number of students. The more the OSCE station, the greater the number of students examined in one circuit. A circuit consists of a complete set of all the stations in an OSCE. Circuits are either repeated or replicated, where students are made. Replication will shorten your total examination time, but it will require more facilities, both in space and the examiners. This is an example of a station OSCE, which is not 1G, but you have seen how it goes different. Station 1 is history of chest pain, next one is read EKG, next one is history of abdominal pain, next one is read X-rays, next one is a suture station, next one is an IV insert. The other 7 and 8 are couplets. You take history from an elder who was suffering from domestic abuse, and then you write out all the plans and what you found. Now, this is an example of a 15-station, 5-minute OSCE blueprint covering guiding history, post-encounter, physical examination, rest station, then obstetric history, post-encounter, and then 7 general physical examination or an obstetric examination of a pregnant woman, rest, another one guiding history, then post-encounter, an obstetric history, second station, post-encounter, rest, monitoring, labor monitoring, concerning pathographs, station 15, communication skills, like giving medical instruction to a patient with informed consent, I would say. More stations can be added if needed, such as instrument identification, reading on the HHD film, interpretation, semen analysis, laboratory report. Also, you find out that oftentimes we have pictures, what we call picture tests. Some people call it electronic OSCE. It entails viewing clinical slides on a general computer screen, maybe up to 30 slides. Each slide contains a clinical picture, a clinical procedure, a figure, and equipment, laboratories, or a case scenario. Questions will be asked, either with short responses or true false fashion. And this slide will be projected 1 to 3 minutes, depending on what you are testing. For MCQ type questions, 1 minute will be enough, and up to 2 to 3 minutes may be necessary for short responses. These are just a few examples. Look at this concerned edition shown below this edition. The questions are there for candidate to answer. This may be true or false. This is another example of in which a pregnant woman is being seen abdominal examination, and these are the questions that could be asked. You can see the number G says, what would be the estimated fetal weight of a fetus in 5 presentation of which this activity shows 34 centimeter and fetal head? That's one of the things. Now, you need to develop a picture test bank as you walk during the day in the theater, in the clinic, in the ward. You can use your phone to take clinical pictures in which you can assign questions to them later and then use them for examination. Now, there are threats to blueprints. If you want to avoid, you know, an examination that's not valid, you take note of this. What are the threats? The thing that will threaten the validity of your exam is construct under representation, where you have not represented some important areas of the curriculum and you ignore them. And then the other one, construct irrelevant variants, where you are testing things that are not important and using your time in an unprofitable way. Of course, you have random error, which is accepted in a research. What are the threats to reliability? Insufficient number of stations. It is said that you need at least 10 stations to be able to make any judgment. Then rater accuracy. If your raters are not trained and they are not accurately scoring, it will affect the reliability of the exam. Then inter-rater variance, where some people are well-trained examiners, others are not well-trained, so that there is wide scatter in their rating, even in the same team. They have intra-rater variance, where the examiner himself, with himself, is not concentrating. Then you have different portrayals by SP. If you didn't train your SPs well, they will not be consistent and accurate
in the portrayal of their scripts. Now, the clinical case can be portrayed or simulated by the SPs and used at the stations will be carefully constructed. We are talking about writing the scripts now. Writing the scripts. So, if you want to write scripts that we use, you have to be sure that the clinical cases that the portrayal should be simulated by the person and used at the station will be carefully constructed to mimic real clinical scenarios.